The first question we're going to discuss is, are children and infants susceptible to COVID-19? Are some more susceptible to a more severe form of the disease? Are they carriers of it and possibly spreading transmission? So let's discuss a study titled Diagnosis, Treatment, and Prevention of 2019 Novel Coronavirus Infection in Children, Experts' Consensus Statement. It was published in February of 2020. It stated, most infected children have mild clinical manifestations. They often have no fever or symptoms of pneumonia with good prognosis. Most of them recover within 1 to 2 weeks after disease onset. Few may progress to lower respiratory infections. Another study titled Epidemiological Characteristics of 2,143 Pediatric Patients with 2019 Coronavirus Disease in China was published in March. This study reports that epidemiological characteristics and transmission patterns of these pediatric patients with COVID-19 in China. The study found that children of all ages were susceptible to COVID-19 with no significant gender differences observed. Clinical manifestations of pediatric patients were generally less severe than those of adult patients. However, young children, particularly infants, were more vulnerable to the SARS-CoV-2 infection. Among symptomatic children, 5% had shortness of breath or low levels of oxygen in the blood, and 0.6% progressed to acute respiratory distress syndrome, or multi-organ system dysfunction. These levels are much lower than those seen in adults. Infants younger than 1 year were more likely to have severe illness compared to older children. Researchers have speculated that a few possible reasons could explain why children experience less severe disease than adults. SARS-CoV-2 virus exploits the angiotensin-converting enzyme 2, or ACE2 as it's called, receptor, to gain entry into cells. Perhaps the maturity and function or binding ability of the ACE2 receptor in children may be lower than that in adults. Children's immune systems are still developing and may respond to pathogens very differently than adults. Children also often experience respiratory infections like RSV in winter and may have higher levels of antiviral antibodies compared to adults. So let's address the question about the role children play in COVID-19 transmission. Understanding how COVID-19 affects children is vital to slowing the pandemic. A study titled COVID-19 in Children, Initial Characterization of the Pediatric Disease press release, published in March of 2020, summarizes, children are less likely to become severely ill than older adults. Children may play a major role in community-based viral transmission. Children may have more upper respiratory tract involvement than lower respiratory tract involvement. But there is still much to learn about the impact of this virus on children, as well as the impact of children on viral spread. There are some subpopulations of children with an increased risk for more significant illness. Those seem to include infants and preschoolers, immunocompromised children, children with other pulmonary health problems. This has also been reported for non-COVID-19 coronavirus infections. A meta-analysis including 45 published studies on COVID-19 found, as of March 18, 2020, children have accounted for about 1 to 5% of diagnosed COVID-19 cases. They often have milder disease than adults, and deaths have been extremely rare. Diagnostic findings have been similar to adults, with fever and respiratory symptoms being prevalent, but fewer children seem to have developed severe pneumonia. Elevated inflammatory markers were less common in children, and lymphocytopenia, which are low levels of lymphocytes in the blood, was rare. The clinical spectrum of children with COVID-19 has often been similar to that of influenza. On the topic of persistent fecal shedding of the virus, out of 10 pediatric SARS-CoV-2 infection cases, 8 children persistently tested positive on rectal swabs even after nasopharyngeal testing was negative, raising the possibility of fecal-oral transmission. However, we do not have evidence of replication-competent virus in fecal swabs, which is required to confirm the potential for fecal-to-oral transmission. On the topic of mother-to-child transmission of COVID-19, mother-to-child transmission of diseases, also known as vertical transmission, can occur during pregnancy. Several viruses, including hepatitis B, herpes varicella zoster, which is chickenpox, and human immunodeficiency virus, or HIV, can be passed via vertical transmission. A recent report indicates that SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19, is not transmissible from pregnant mothers to their infants at birth. The report describes the clinical course of four live-born, full-term infants born to pregnant women who tested positive for COVID-19 in Wuhan, China. Three of the four infants did not test positive for the virus. The mother of the fourth infant did not provide consent for testing. None of the infants manifested clinical signs of COVID-19, such as respiratory or gastrointestinal problems, but two had mild rashes at birth. One of the infants developed breathing problems but responded to non-invasive mechanical ventilation. Although three of the four infants described in the report were born via cesarean section, one was born vaginally and did not test positive for the virus. All the infants were isolated after birth and were formula fed. The authors of a report collected placenta, amniotic fluid, neonatal blood, gastric fluid, and anal swab samples from the infants for further study. Another study titled Clinical Characteristics and Interuterine Vertical Transmission Potential of COVID-19 Infection in 9 Pregnant Women also found that there was no evidence of SARS-CoV-2 viral transmission from mother to child in 9 births from COVID-19 infected women. All 9 births were done by cesarean section in the third trimester. Amniotic fluid, cord blood, neonatal throat swab, and breast milk samples from 6 patients were tested for SARS-CoV-2, and all samples tested negative for the virus. The clinical characteristics of COVID-19 pneumonia in pregnant women were similar to those reported for non-pregnant adult patients who developed COVID-19 pneumonia. And yet another study titled An Analysis of 38 Pregnant Women with COVID-19, Their Newborn Infants and Maternal Fetal Transmission of SARS-CoV-2 actually described 38 pregnant women with COVID-19 and their newborns in China. The report found there was no evidence of SARS-CoV-2 undergoing any type of intrauterine or transplacental transmission from infected pregnant women to the fetuses. Since all of the published data seems to indicate that infants born to mothers with COVID-19 do not actively have the SARS-CoV-2 virus, the question is, what about antibodies from this virus? So a publication found that among 6 mothers with confirmed COVID-19, SARS-CoV-2 was not detected in the serum or throat swab in any of their newborns. However, virus-specific antibodies were detected in neonatal blood sera samples. IgG concentrations were elevated in 5 infants, and IgG normally crosses the placenta, and IgM concentrations were elevated in 2 infants. So IgM is a larger molecule, and it's not thought to usually cross the placenta. So this either indicates that maybe the placenta could possibly be damaged in COVID-19, allowing the IgM to cross the placenta, or the SARS-CoV-2 may cross the placenta and could result in the infant in producing the IgM. That's 2 possibilities. We're not sure exactly what's causing the infants to have the elevated IgM concentrations. So the CDC has recommendations for the care of pregnant women and breastfeeding. They recommend that a mother with COVID-19 still continues to breastfeed since the virus does not seem to be present in breast milk, but they should wash their hands before touching the infant and wear a face mask if possible while feeding at the breast.